So welcome to the Architects Workshop. This is our first episode. And the first one was, I don't think we thought it was up to the mark, and therefore we decided to do it again. In the grand tradition of all architecture students everywhere, we decided to redo it. I think the content deserves a second chance. I think our idea should have been explained a little better. But for today, what we want to start off with is tell you who we are. We are the Architects Workshop. We are India-based. We are a bunch of architects, and so we are a bunch of architects in various stages of our career. We have people who've been in the field for close to 15 years, 10 years, 3 years, and so on, and even a couple of students. And all of us are working on this together with the hope that we give back to this community that we so love. And through all our social media and our videos that we are going to create, we hope that we create a community, a bunch of us who are interested in learning and who don't mind spending a little time listening to people, if necessary, improving our own ideas, getting better information from all over the internet and sharing it with each other. In this sense, we have a number of things that we are doing, a number of ideas that we plan to host. And a few of them here are, we have something called the Architectural Web Tools and our courses as of now. These are the two things that we've launched so far. But we do have other things in the pipeline, things like a podcast where we talk about design with, as in practical design, and what it takes to actually work, and how do you use a concept in your office and things like that. Because we struggle with even concepts in college. And so you would think that in the practical field, we don't consider it at all, but that's patently false. So things like that. Then we have ideas of a separate website altogether that just collects resources for students and things like that, which could be something like, excuse me, which could be something like a news channel effectively. But these are in the pipeline. For today, for now, we have something. We have something that we are launching. This is the first episode of Practical Architecture. This is our crash course for interns and interns of architecture, of course, who are joining their office in their 8th to 9th or the 10th semester, depending on which college you are in and which syllabus you follow. And the way we hope to do this is through talking about basic concepts in architecture. I think the last live stream we went into too much technical detail way at the beginning without introducing the reason why. So the crash course for interns hopes to deal with the process of practical construction and how our designs and drawings tend to solve problems on site preemptively. So we've actually designed the solutions before we actually go ahead. We are hoping to show you the practical logic behind the design rather than the particular details that you can borrow for your own design. So we won't go through too many different types of details and things like that. But the hope is that you will understand the logic behind it and hopefully design your own details and are enabled enough to do that. We hope to present the content in a manner that enables you to take the basic information and use it to design your own design and solutions. We define ourselves as the bridge between the theory of college and the practicality of office. We don't, in either case, replace either one. Right? We build on and remind you of the syllabus that you learnt in college. This we have obviously our own ideas of what has to be taught and what you should know as an architect before as you're graduating from college, and we have borrowed rather heavily from quite a few universities from across the world. We've gone through a lot of research in trying to figure out how best to explain the things that we want to do. We've had conversations with very many senior architects, and they've given us their inputs as well. And teachers, of course, and a lot of teachers who've given us their inputs of what is taught in college, how we could help out. And the idea is that we are hopefully a lot more the idea is that we are hopefully more like a team that works with the colleges and the offices and work between the two as mostly a bridge, as mostly just the process, just helping people out where they may struggle. And because we have found that offices struggle with trainees, and colleges don't know how to better prepare them because of various reasons. We have so much to cover during our college syllabus that we might not give this as much importance as this deserves. We do hope these restrictions allow us to be more creative in how we teach and the content we create. Just like when you are given an essay, say we said, okay, you have an hour or you have 2 hours, write us an essay, and we left it at that, you would spend close to an hour trying to figure out what you want to talk about, what your essay should be even. So any restriction, say we came in and said instead that in an hour you give us an essay on Louis Sullivan or Mies van der Rohe or something like a non-architectural subject like the history of India, the British colonization or anything like that, you would spend way less time thinking about what to do rather than how you do it and the content itself. So the hope is that our entire company and everything we do is very content based rather than the idea of just having a lot of flash and just yapping off about things. Quite honestly, we tend to have a lot of jargon in our industry. We tend to have people aspiring to be starchitects, and we don't have such aspirations. We are a country of 1.3 billion. We have a worldwide population of 7 odd billion, and most of them aren't living in those really fancy houses that we see all over the place. And when I say all over the place, I mean obviously just magazines, right? Because when you walk on the street, you see how the regular man lives. And we as architects can improve that entire situation. So with that, I think we'll jump straight into the content itself of what we're trying to do with this course. So we are the Architects Workshop India. Welcome back. So today we are going to be dealing with the same stuff that we did in the episode last time, but in a slightly better manner, hopefully. But before we jump into this episode and the content and explaining the plan and things like that, I think it's important for us to discuss what it is that an architect does. What is an architect's profession? What does he do on a daily basis? And why should a client even hire us, right? And there are obviously a lot of explanations as to explaining all the different theories behind it, the design processes, and all the famous architects that we know. But on a very, very simple idea, an architect is one who designs buildings. And an architect is one who designs buildings, and the way we design buildings involves a lot of separate things that we consider, from practical knowledge that has been handed down to us from generations, to scientific theories that are coming up every day, to problems that we face on a worldwide level, from climate change to globalization and things like that, to the very, very simple ideas of space, right? And what it means to occupy the space, and what it means to design the space such that there are it is used in a better manner, or in some way advances the people's the users there itself, right? The way we do that is rather simultaneous, right? And it is not a very linear process. We consider all of these things and more, and somehow figure out how to put all of that in to a simple structure while keeping it economical, and everything else that goes into the construction industry itself. We are also aware that the construction industry is a good 75% of a lot of spending that close to 50% of the energy spent in the world is into the construction industry itself, supposedly. And another further 20 to 25% is the transportation. So all the cars and everything that we have been cribbing about all this while is much lesser than our buildings. And this is through things like embodied energy and stuff like that. But more than that, we as architects in our day-to-day business are trying to make the process of construction easier. Process of construction easier for the client, especially. So when a client comes to you with a particular idea of what has to be done, we start with the very basics of a site. And in the site, we look through, we look at the different dimensions involved, the site dimensions, the ideas of how big it is. Then we do surveys of the area around it, figure out our neighboring plots, figure out what kind of land use is around here, and based on that we try to design our own site in some better way or the other, right? Assuming there's a road in front, then the width of the road, where the gate comes, and so on. But assuming we've done all of that, that is design that we learn in college. That is literally the design that we do for the entire 6 to 7 semesters that we are in college for. It is the process after this. What happens when you have an actual, fleshed out design that... Switched off. Okay, I will turn the background volume way lower. There you go. Is that better? The idea here is that we are going to be looking at the process of design after the basic SketchUp models are made, and the initial forms are created, and the renders done, and all of the basic ideas of convincing a client, or in your case, convincing a teacher. Once that design is done, which is what we present, so these are our basic plans, sections, and elevations, right? So if these are our plans, hello, check. Okay, sorry. These are plans that we work with, and we have our our sections and elevations and everything developed as well. We have, just one moment please, I'm getting the sections here. So elevations like this, so these are detailed elevations. These aren't very simple elevations that we create in college. These aren't renders. These are construction elevations. So I'm talking about the process that happens after we've finished our basic design. Our entire form is complete. We've sorted out all the different issues in terms of the structure, in terms of the details involved, in terms of what is to be constructed, where the shape of it, and so on. At this point is when we start looking at our construction drawings themselves. And the point of construction drawings is mostly because we architects don't spend all day on site. We are in the office. We handle very many projects and we can't be at all the sites at the same time. In this sense, we tend to go to site, not rarely, of course not. We go there often enough to check the work that the masons and the contractors are doing, which ends up being about maybe once a week for a simple site. Or rather a slightly more complex site, and for a much more simple house and things like that, maybe even once a month, depending on how fast the work is progressing on site. And what we do when we go to site is, basically look at all the different drawings that we've given, just to make sure that the construction follows them, right? In theory, we are not designing anything on site. We may solve a few issues, if at all, if they arise, but we are never designing anything on site. Generally, there are architects who are famous for doing just that. There are people, as in architects like Laurie Baker and people like that, who are famous for running an entire site with just a couple of sketches. To do that, we truly need to be a master. To at our level, at the very beginnings of our career, to run around with just one sketch and convince all the different people who are working on your site what they have to do, give them work every day and so on, doesn't actually work, right? So in general, let's go through an approximate idea of all the different drawings we need in some kind of an order. At the very beginning, we need just the plan sections and elevations. Right, I'm going to put that up on the right side in the notes section. So these will keep scrolling through rather slowly and stuff like that. We'll keep adding more drawings as and when we talk about them. But as of now, all we have are the ground floor plan, first floor plan, roof plan, the OHT or the overhead tank, and the and then we have all the different sections that we've drawn. Notice that it's not just one section somewhere, and these are important sections. So they're not just sections where you have to do the least amount of work, right? These are drawings where we have to explain as much as we can, as we possibly can cram into a drawing, as much information as we can cram into a piece of paper. And this is the piece of paper that represents us on site. So with this, we're looking at the section itself. These are, again, basic sections. These aren't absolutely finished sections. The first set of drawings are mostly just so that the rest of the work can actually start. We'll start with the ground floor plan, and actually, why not? We'll go through the first floor plan as well, and then move on to. I think we'll start with the roof plan, no? And I'll tell you why we start with the roof plan. In terms of design, in terms of architectural design, we go through the process rather simultaneously. Which is to say that if you're truly designing a building well, you are thinking of it in terms of the section, you're thinking of it in terms of the elevation, you're thinking of it in terms of the different details and so on, all at the same time, right? And while you're doing stuff like that, we can't really call it a linear process. It's not like you first develop a plan, you draw some layout out, and then you develop your sections from there, and then your elevation from there. Because at the end of the day, our aesthetics matter. Our the space that we are creating is a volume. It is not a 2D space. And when you have all these considerations, you can't build. You can't design a structure with just a single plan and so on. Even while thinking about it, we have ideas of things like double height spaces, of things like cutouts, of ideas like solids and voids, of all sorts of simple ideas like that. These aren't very very complex ideas. So just to explain the plan itself a little, so we are kind of orientable, so to speak, so we kind of understand the plan, so we can talk a little further using this as an example. This, as of now, has been designed with the north, as in the drawings are with the north to the left of the drawing. So we're actually facing there. So we're facing as in the entrances are thing and things are facing the east direction. So we have our entry and foyer area, and you come across here into the living. So this forms a kind of a private space for the living with a set of doors leading out into another porch, which is again slightly more private and cut off from the rest of the site. When you enter here, we have the kitchen. Okay, let's just call this two separate wings on either side. So on one side, we have the kitchen and a connected utility store and things like that leading out into the backyard space. And on either side, we have two bedrooms. And attached to them, at least attached to one bedroom, is the bath. And the other side, we have a powder room, which is connected to the dining space, because we'd have like a hand wash area there and things like that. This dining space is has a cutout here, which leaves this wall here as a double height feature wall or something like that, with a window on the other side. And we have this floating slab in between these two wings, let's call them. The idea of the backyard is most, one second please. So this is our first floor, and on the first floor, you come up the stairs here, and this area is the one that is cut out. So we have a bridge sort of situation happening here. So this is our secondary living space. This is hopefully our family, chill out zone, let's call it. That kind of looks down onto our feature wall and things like that. So this is our family space that leads out onto a terrace here. And another balcony here, which is connected through this from this bedroom as well. This bedroom is kind of designed as the master bedroom. So you'll notice that it's slightly bigger, but that's not what we're talking about. In terms of the interiors, we have ideas of a dresser here and things like that. And going up to the roof itself, again, just hold on, please, one second. Just finding the drawings themselves. So the roof itself is basically designed as two sloping roofs on either side above our two wings. So our bedrooms happen around here and our bathrooms approximately here. This center section, which is our the bridge section, is kind of covered with a flat terrace. We have what is looking down here, we can see the balcony in front. This balcony is completely under the sloping roof itself. This is our backyard, and this is our porch, and so on. You'll also notice this particular area here. This is the highest point of the roof itself. Let's just zoom in a little bit. So basically, the idea is that the roof here is where the overhead tank will sit. So we'll notice that this is a sloping roof. This is a wooden detailed terracotta tiled roof, right? It's a sloping roof. It's a very regular sloping roof. We haven't tried to do anything crazy through this entire house. But in terms of structure, right, after our first form is kind of done, once we've decided what is happening where, one thing that we all forget to do is add the water tank on top. Without the water tank, none of these things work. None of the plumbing works. None of your bathrooms work. And very few buildings exist without bathrooms, really. So it is important that we just put our water tanks in place. It is important that we think of things like sumps or underground water tanks or much larger water tanks from where we can pump water up into our overhead water tanks. And from using the pressure of the overhead tanks, we can then plumb them back into our bathrooms and so on. So considering that this is approximately the highest point on site, let's look at the section itself. So this is the overhead tank space, right? We have not, again, detailed it out in terms of where the slab is, where the roof is, what is happening above it. Is it a Syntex tank? Is it a concrete tank that is built on top and then filled with water ever so often? But the important thing to notice is that one, it's drawn. That changes the form of the house itself, which is important to note. So while doing these things, it is important to realize that the beautiful form that we've created, the simple form that we've created, possibly has a tower at the back. And that tower either is highlighted and you bring that into the design itself, or it just looks ugly, right? And more than just aesthetics, the location of the water tank kind of determines all the pipe locations, where the water flows from, all the different connections that we need from that one water tank to all the different bathrooms, to the kitchen, and so on. If we have the tank in one corner, then the plumbing has to flow through the entire building along walls and things like that. If we try to embed the piping into the walls themselves, then we have other issues, like in case there's a leak, then what do we do, right? So just to emphasize the point that yes, that one tower on top is slightly important. So please pay attention to that. Please make sure that you add those the water tower or basically what we consider our water tanks themselves and right up on top. The issue with the water tank right up on top is, of course, that it's a very, very heavy structure. Right, we are talking about, okay, let's do basic calculations. What is the actually forget calculations, even just imagine the tank on top of your house. The tank on top of your house is generally one of those black Syntex or similar brand versions, and in those brand versions of this thing, we have about 1,000 liters. If there is 1,000 liters of water somewhere, whatever volume it might take and everything, that will kind of determine the size in terms of the volume and how we stack it and what the shape of the vessel itself. But how heavy is it going to be? Actually, I think we'll let the chat answer that. I'm going to wait for the chat to do wait for the chat to actually answer that one question. In the meanwhile, I will go on to why that is important. Right. So how much weight do you think the overhead tank actually is? Now, considering whatever weight it might be, this is on top of your entire building. So this weight is transmitted into the slab below, and from the slab below in into the slabs, into the columns, possibly into the other slab and beams that exist there, into even more columns, into another beam structure there, and it below into the foundations and so on. So when you have all these number of structures that you need, the weight of the entire building becomes super heavy, right? It is not a light structure anymore. Not like we were trying to design a light structure in the first place. We simply haven't thought about weight, have we? What is the weight of a wall? What is the weight of a slab? What is the weight of a beam? We've only calculated them in some parts, and we call them the dead load of a building, right? That's the only weight we've given it, right? And so in this, when we look at, okay, can we turn this right in some way? Okay. One second. I'll just turn this right. Counterclockwise, clockwise. Yes, Lord bless everybody. Cool. So this works. All right. So in our section, right, we were talking about all the different beams and slabs and chajjas and walls and the weight of all of them. We are looking at a lot of weight, and all of that weight is taken by this one foundation thing at the very bottom. So the way you calculate in terms of a structural drawing, say, is you start at the very top. You start at the slab at the very top, which is generally your overhead water tank. And from there, you move downwards and you calculate the load of each one, the live load, the dead load, the variable loads, the wind load if you're constructing very high, or if you're building in a very windy area. And from there, once you've designed the slab itself, then we design the beam that is, say we're designing this slab, then we design the beam that is holding the slab. So the beam gets some dimensions after we figured out the reinforcement of the slabs. With the beam dimensions, we then realize that the beam plus the slab is that heavy, is a particular weight, because we now know the volume. Then we have to calculate the columns themselves and how the columns actually take the load of all the beams and the slabs above it. And once those things come down, it goes down one by one. So we actually start structural calculations right up on top, right up at the very top of your structure, and then move downwards, adding the weight of each and every part that we calculate, right? So I think at this point we can add our structural drawings into our drawing list. So our structural drawings here, copy and paste. So now we'll notice that, okay, so once we've given the structural engineer the first set of plans and elevations and sections and whatever other form based details we need, and mostly just cutouts for the window. He doesn't really need the detail of the window and things. He just assumes a basic value for it. So once we have all these plans and sections and elevations, we send them to the structural engineer. The structural engineer then understands the form in as much detail as he can. And once he has the Abhilash has answered. Since it is equivalent to 1 liter is equivalent to 1 kilogram, and the tanks weigh without water, say 15 to 20 kilograms, is it 1,015 and 1,020 kilograms? Except for, as in the tank itself actually weighs quite a lot more than just 15, 20 kilograms, I would think. But we're just talking about the water here, and you're absolutely right. It's 1,000 kilograms, right? The water on top of your entire building is a ton. In the smallest, as in assuming there's just one family that lives there or something, and you put just the one tank up, yeah, that's a ton of water right up on top. So imagine building. Let's do an analogy. Let's say you have a number of matchsticks, or let's say toothpicks or something like that, and you build a structure. And you build a structure by tying these toothpicks together in some kind of a framework. And with this One second. Actually, I will find toothpicks and we can do this live. Hold on. Okay, so let's hope this works. And yes, I'm sorry, but being the camera, this thing might lag a slight bit. So I will try to be as slow as possible while talking about this section, such that in case there is some kind of a lag, at least you'll be able to follow. All right. So let's start with two basic columns. Let's call them. Okay, arranging them to be as vertical as possible. Yeah. So approximately, let's say we have. Okay. So there's supposedly a 5 second delay in what we are in what I'm doing to what you are, or rather, in between the audio and the video itself. So I apologize for that, but unfortunately, as of this stream, we can't do too much. We are hoping to solve that issue soon. So let's say we have something heavy, right? And this is a box of basically blades. And let's assume that these two are our columns, right? Or in section. So assuming this is very, very heavy, this particular structure here, which is our blades and everything. It will, and this is very tall, assuming the columns are very tall. What tends to happen is it'll either go down this way or it'll go down to the other side. Ultimately, your columns will collapse, mostly because of something that we call a slenderness ratio. Again, this is something that we might have studied in college way back when. In your structures class, if you paid attention. But the slenderness ratio, actually, that's another question that I'm going to put to you people. What is the slenderness ratio of a column? What does it mean? While you're thinking about that, the idea of of a very heavy structure right up on top will basically tend to destabilize the structure. I wish I could show 3D models. Maybe I'll work on that for the next stream and figure out some way to actually show you models while talking about this rather than like a 2D version of a model. But anyway, coming back to our sections themselves. So in our sections, you'll notice that on the right, initially, before we go into the sections, the structural drawings. So we've sent the structural drawings out to our structural guy, the engineer. He sat and figured out what the form actually is, what spaces we have, all the different what's the center lines and things that we've given, what dimensions, spans, materials we're planning to use, all of that. Considers all of them, calculates the exact structure that is required in a particular building in terms of the reinforcement and things like that. With that, he sends back the structural drawings, right? So all the things that you see on the right are drawings that he does and sends them back to you. With this set of drawings, we incorporate them back into our plans. Because he might have suggested a column that is slightly bigger than yours. He might have suggested a column that is slightly displaced from the plans that you might have sent. For example, in our, okay, we have to come back to counterclockwise. Yes, okay. This is one thing that's always confused me. Counterclockwise and clockwise. I don't know why. It's a simple concept as a clock. But anyway. In terms of our plan, say here we have a grid line along this, as in our EE grid line, and here we have one column, two columns, three, four, possibly a fifth one there. We have avoided it, possibly a sixth one there, and on the outside, possibly a seventh one there. These are all the intersections, right? And we can place columns as architects wherever we want, and we have decided that. In this structure,
Let's zoom in a slight bit. Let's zoom into the kitchen area. Along this line, we have decided that our kitchen slab itself will have some kind of a weird structure, which is to say that this beam, this column is the last one here. We didn't want another column there. So this area is actually cantilevered out, right? So there are two beams that come and cantilever out. We've left this like this as a question to the structural engineer. So the structural engineer decides that, listen, that cantilever is too large, or it's going to be too expensive, or any other of the million reasons that he is considering, as in he is an engineer, that's his job. So if he figures out some reason why this particular column has to be there, he will suggest that we put it in. And if we have that as our column in that corner, that changes our design to a certain level. How does that change our design? The design, we are looking at the kitchen, all right? And in our kitchen, we have a window that is going from edge to edge. We have one wall here. If you put a column there, what happens? What are the different effects that it has? It kind of restricts where we can position our sink, for instance. How does it restrict where we put our sink? Purely because we have to figure out where the pipes are going through, the inlet and the outlet pipes, right? And how these things actually are connected, even the installation of it, we have to think about. We have to think about the electrical wires. So assuming you have this thing, you can't have any electrical wires or even lights on along here, because transferring lines across walls, or rather across columns, is kind of annoying. You kind of have to plan for it way in advance. So which is why we have our electrical plans and everything also figured out as early as we can. Right, and in our electrical plans, we can figure out where the different sockets for the kitchen are, and where the all the different appliances that we have to put into a kitchen, whether it's a fridge possibly around here, do we need another counter here, if we put a counter here, can we put our microwave and other things along this wall. All of these things matter even while discussing structure, because in our structural drawings, as in once our structural engineer has sent in his drawings, we incorporate that into our own set of drawings and add details like basically pipes through which we can take our wires and things, even if they have to be cast in place earlier. Like how we consider, like as a simple example, your fan locations in your room. Say we're looking at this bedroom. The fan locations here have to be determined way in advance. And once it's determined in advance, we put the different hooks and things like that in place, and that they have to be incorporated into the ceiling structure itself. So the reinforcement, as in this, is possibly welded onto the reinforcement or something like that. And obviously the wiring has to come through. The wiring is not stuck to the ceiling. You can't chip a ceiling and then you can't make a groove in the ceiling from your switchboard and then put the wires in. They have to be cast in place. Which is why all these drawings are required from the very beginning, right? So it's not just the next set of drawings like the electrical plan and things like that, but fair bit more detail in terms of even the structure itself, even the actual geometry of the structure. Which so far we haven't needed, as a structural engineer hasn't needed, but for it to be constructed on site, obviously all these details are necessary. And by that I mean things like your door window schedules, your staircase and details like that. Where is that? This staircase, for instance, has to be detailed out as to where the railings are, what kind of levels we are talking about, the exact precise construction methodology. Whether we are talking about a flat slab, whether we are talking about a waste slab, whether this is even concrete, is it a steel thing, is it wood? We have a lot of options. And all of these details have to be put into our drawing set, our drawing list. Then we have then we as we were talking about the electrical and plumbing details, which we'll add here. So sanitary and plumbing work are electrical drawings and things like that. And then obviously our kitchen and utility details, which are a separate set of complications. I mean, they are so complicated. There was actually one live stream that I'd done earlier regarding just kitchens, and that was like an hour and a half or something. They are rather interesting to design for because of the amount of technology that truly goes into kitchen these days, from modularity onwards. It's rather interesting to look at all of them. And the other drawings that we'll be looking at are finishing details, fabrication details, landscape details. Right, just adding them here. So all these different drawings, you can see, as in this thing on our side, our notes section seems to be scrolling forever. The end of our drawings never seem to come, and that I think is a very, very good analogy of what happens in an office. So the actual process of design in an office is you speak to your client, you understand what they need, you basically create a brief. Once you have a brief, you sit and come up with conceptual drawings of these things. So these are your sketches, these are your views of different things, pencil sketches and stuff like that, to get the initial ideas out. Once you have these initial ideas, you go back to the client, you present this present your basic ideas to them. They then give you pros and cons. They like this part, they don't like that part. What about that one? What about this one? I don't like this. And so on. Once you get all of those ideas, you come back to the office, you work on concept level 2 and concept level 3 and 4 and 5 and 6 and how many ever levels of concept there it takes. It is not just one person who comes up with a drawing and is says this is it, this is all that will ever be built, we are not designing anything else, I'm the architect, you're just the client, or anything like that. Architects serve the client. Every building is interesting because it has different clients, it has different functions. We cannot just say it has a signature and whatever else, and design our own signature something and put that for all buildings. That's just boring. That is impractical, really. But so once we've gotten to the end of our concept stage, we get a sign off from the client. So the clients finally agree to the design itself, whether it's in plan section, whatever, all the different forms. In some cases, renderings might be required and stuff like that, just to explain the structure itself. But once we have finished with the client stage of things, then we kind of move on to the engineering. And that is where the true office work starts. And that is what we hope to cover in this entire course. That is what, as in the generation of all these drawings, is dependent on that. So even after you come up with the basic form, the design still is there. As you're drawing each part out, you're designing certain things. Whether it's a regular thing of where the lights are located, or even in your electrical drawing, those switchboards, which switch goes where, whether on the top row, on the bottom row, should the plug point be on the bottom left or the top left, and where should the switch for that be, and so on. When we start designing like that, that is when we start detailing out really. When we can say, oh, the switchboard is here, but what if we made that out of wood? Is that going to cause a fire? Then can we figure out some way to make this in some with some other detail, and so on. That is where architecture truly comes alive. That is where experiencing space and things like that become that much more heightened because of these small details and things like that. And unless we know how to design these things, I don't think we can even call ourselves good architects. So the point of the course really is to teach you all of these things and more. Most of these things are obviously already done in the many offices that you plan to join, they have their own systems in place, they have their own design thoughts in place, but what we are hoping to cover is a more generic version of it, such that whichever office you go into later, you can jump into their process. It is important to realize that each office functions differently from the others because of the type of setup they are, the number of people working there, and so on. So yes, with that, I think we'll come to the end of our first episode. We will take any and all questions that you may have. Please comment on Facebook and on YouTube. We will be here for a little while longer. I think we'll play some music and leave the chat alive. So thank you for watching. If you have, we hope that this has helped a few of you and has more importantly enticed a few of you to possibly take join this course and join us in this journey of betterment, let's say. One more important thing is any errors that you might have found, we would like for you to email them with the word error in the subject to architectsworkshopindia@gmail.com. This is mostly because architecture is a constantly developing field, and if there is anything that we have to learn, we will definitely do so. That is kind of the point of doing it. We do not think that we are we have completed learning. I don't think very many people do, and as much as we are applying all the knowledge that we have, we realize that there is lots more to get, and we are very happy to receive any suggestions that you may have, any criticism that you may have. So please do write in and let us know what you thought. Also, please share, like, comment, subscribe, follow, and all the other words that they tend to come up with on social media. Please support us in this venture that we've started off on. Thank you. I will leave the links above again, such that you can go here and check out the other videos that we may have done and other posts that we have done. I will also leave a video to a link to our website itself, such that you may check that out and check out the details that we have and as in all the other things. I would also encourage the slightly more adventurous of you to go into this. Wait, this is kind of interesting. I would like to just show this off for a second. Here, in our website, please select here, go to Architectural Web Tools, click on that and follow the links there. There are a couple of videos hidden within that and we are hoping that they help mostly students. So this is kind of designed for the student community themselves. So yes, with that, I think we'll end the stream. Thanks for watching. Glad to have you here. And please do join us every time we do this. Yeah? So subscribe, like, all of that. Thank you. Thanks a lot for watching.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.